baptized to that. How did you cope with that? Because that must have been an extreme high to come to, you know, back to, or was it comforting for you at the time?
No, it was definitely comforting. Definitely comforting. I didn't feel, I mean, it was a crazy time. Remember, it was when we did the Eurovision, we were already number five in the charts. The BBC in those days used to really promote the British entry. So, you know, whereas now you hardly ever hear the song, and that's very unfair. It's very unfair. But yeah, so by the time we did Eurovision, we already had a top five single, and we knew that we were going to go up. It went up to number two, and then it went to number one, obviously. So, and it went to number one in nine countries around the world. So then we had to, literally, we had the next day off, the Sunday. The Monday we had a big meeting with the record label and with the production, and what are we going to do next? We had to bring on a manager and stuff like that. And the next day we flew to Switzerland, and then to Germany, and then to Holland, and then to Italy, and then to France. And it just went nuts. We spent at least 9 or 10 months of the next year promoting singles abroad. We would always come back to do Top of the Pops, because that was, we had it written in our contract. It was a clause in our contract. Whatever we were doing, wherever we were in the world, it would stop if we got Top of the Pops. So, and it was a crazy time, but I still lived in my council flat, and I still came home to my mum and dad and my brothers, and my sister was married. She lived over the road. So I still saw them, and I still saw my mates from school, you know, and I still do. In fact, we've been texting today. So, I just had this other hat that I wear, and I still wear it. And so I'm still Rita. I'm Rita Stroud now, and I've been for 30 years, but I'm still Rita, and I wear Cheryl Baker. And I really like that I can separate the two, because Cheryl Baker can be flamboyant. She can go on stage. She can be in your face singing at you and going crazy. And Rita Stroud is actually a lot more shy. Like, I hate if I'm at a family party and they say, sing a song. I can't bear it. I get so... not nervous, but like inhibited, you know. It's so I enjoyed those early years of Bucks Fizz, the craziness, and then coming back to normality. We had in our council flat, I had limousines coming to pick us up. We lived on the second floor, and so I'd used to look down and see this massive limousine that looked like it was, you know, straight from a funeral parlor or something. Just for me, a great big limousine. It was crazy. I didn't know at the time that they recoup all those costs out of your record royalties. But anyway, and on the wall in our little council flat, we had gold discs, you know, gold albums. And it was, and we flew everywhere first class. Another expense I didn't know came out of our royalties, but there you are. But we did it. I'd flown first class. I'd been in limousines. We'd been to Australia. We'd been to Japan. We'd been to Brazil. We went to places that I never read about. It was fantastic, Rory. It was absolutely amazing. And if we hadn't earned a single penny, I wouldn't have cared. We didn't earn much more than a penny, I've got to say. Our deal was terrible. But, you know, I was absolutely living my dream, my childhood dream. I won the Eurovision Song Contest. And then I went around. I've got a brother in Australia. We gigged in Australia. We flew, and we had, there was a huge bus. It was like a big sort of London Red bus, but they painted it all with Bucks Fizz with our pictures, and we drove all around Sydney, and my brother was with me. It was magical, absolutely magical.
Afraid to give, but I can see it.
So the humbleness then of you going back all the time to East London and the flat and everything, I mean, that's incredible, because you're keeping this grounded approach to everything. I mean, because I mean, I've met so many celebrity superstars, etc., who don't have that grounded thing. Yeah, I mean, it's amazing that you've managed to maintain that all through. I'm curious though, to the name, because you say Cheryl's flamboyant, Cheryl's in your face singing, and Rita's a little bit more shy, and you know. How did you come up with the name Cheryl Baker? What was that a stage name that you created yourself, or was that something that you decided I'm going to go with Cheryl Baker? What's the rhyme or reason behind that?
It was the first band that I joined, because when I saw that advert, going right back to the beginning of our conversation, I saw that advert in the Melody Maker, and I rang, and it was a London number, and it was a manager. And I rang, I said, oh, hi, I'm ringing about the, you know, the girl singer required. And he said, what's your name? And I said, Rita Crudgington. And his exact words were, well, that'll have to go.
Okay. So you went, well, it's no Cheryl Baker.
I didn't come up with another name. I was another name for 2 weeks. I was Bonnie Silver. Because I thought Bonnie was a friendly name and Silver was my mum's maiden name. And I think Silver is a fantastic name. But yeah, they called me Bonnie for 2 weeks, and then they said, actually, we don't like that either. Can you come up with another one? And I don't think it was me that came up with Cheryl. I can't remember, but I don't care. I don't care who came up with it. I don't care who, you know, whether it was me or Uncle Tom Copley. I don't care, because that's not me.
No.
So, just the coat I wear.
Yeah, but it's you know, I mean, it's cool that you've got the two hats, though. I mean,
I love wearing Cheryl Baker. I shall be wearing her on Friday. We've got a gig at a Butlins 80s weekend, which are amazing. You know, you've got 5,000 people dressed in 80s clothes. Whenever there's a group of four, inevitably they're dressed as Bucks Fizz. It's fantastic. We have such a great time at these gigs. And I will be happy to be Cheryl Baker on Friday night. But then on Saturday, I'll be Rita Stroud again, you know, and I'll be like, today what I've been doing, I've been clearing up. I've ordered a couple of frying pans, because, and I've got to order some seeds for me, you know, to grow me vegetables. I do normal stuff. I empty the dishwasher. I washed the dog because he got really muddy today. And you know, so I do normal stuff. But Cheryl Baker does all this crazy stuff, you know, on stage.
Yeah. I mean, so you've won Eurovision. You're at the top of the thing, touring all over. And the journey of Bucks Fizz is kind of really in full flow. I mean, obviously, there must have been comparisons at that point in time to Bucks Fizz and ABBA. And because of them winning Eurovision, you guys winning Eurovision, and Two Girls, Two Guys, et cetera, the whole thing. Was there a pressure after, with each record that comes, you know, especially in those days, record companies phoning up saying, we need another hit, we need another hit, we need another hit. So was there a lot of pressure on you guys at that point in time, studio-wise, or...?
Nope, none, because we didn't have any idea what was going on. It was so crazy. It was all done through Nicola Martin, who came in and saw me working at Mayfair Sound and said, do you want to be in Bucks Fizz? She was the production company, and her husband was the writer. He wrote Making Your Mind Up and 99% of all the rest of our album tracks and hits. And so it was them and the management. They literally, we were puppets. We were sheep. They led us. We'll go this way. Now we're going to go and promote this single. And now we're going to promote that album. We're going to do Top of the Pops. And we literally did as we were told, because we couldn't, we didn't have time. We had no influence at all in our careers. So, and I didn't mind it that way, to be perfectly honest. Neither did Mike. Possibly Jay and Bobby were more about, you know, how much are we earning here? Do we need to do that? Because Bobby was married at that time with a child. And Jay, actually, when she joined Bucks Food, she was only 19 and I was 27. So she was 19 when we did the Eurovision. She was 20 the next month. So she was very young. However, her parents were in show business. And so she was very showbiz savvy. And I wasn't, and I didn't care. I was very happy to just go and do that TV. Yeah, all right then. Go and do that performance. Yeah, all right then. Go and do this promotion. Yeah, all right then. I just loved it.
Yeah, just loved the whole thing. Yeah. I really wanted to speak to you about Eurovision because, I mean, Eurovision in the sense that it's almost been put to some form of, it's not taken seriously as it is in Europe. I mean, in the UK, it's almost a bit of fun. It's a bit of a joke scenario. Graham Norton, prior to that, you had Terry Wogan doing the funny commentary and all the songs. But when you go abroad, I mean, I lived in Sweden for a while. I mean, they take it incredibly.
They take it deadly serious, don't they?
They're pan serious. It's like, you know, this is, you know, they'll sit down with their notepads and everything when they're watching it, and you know, and you're looking at the difference in mentality. I mean, what do you think of the current format in the UK for Eurovision and things like that? To me, every other country has several entries. They have a pre-competition, X, Y, Z. The winner goes through and represents the country for that and so on. But over here, it just feels like it's now in a position where, I don't know, someone selected, you're like, okay, you're representing the UK, you know, and it doesn't feel to be a real process.
Well, we used to do that back in the 60s and 70s. You know, we used to have one artist. It was only when I did it the first time, 1976, that was when it turned into a competition. Before that, you know, Cliff Richard did it twice, didn't he? Olivia Newton-John, the Shadows, whoever did it, Sandy Shaw, they chose the singer and then they chose the song. And generally, it was the British public that would choose the song. So you'd have Cliff Richard, he would have his own show, say, and each week he would sing a different song, and then you would write on a postcard what one you wanted to be to represent us in the Eurovision. So we always did have the singer at first and then choose the song. However, I think that we don't take it seriously enough, as you say, in this country anymore. And I don't just mean from an audience point of view, I mean from the production of it. Because if you look at the production of some of the winning songs, it's phenomenal. And the show is so much better now than it ever was, certainly much, much better than when we did it. That, you know, the explosions, the special effects, the massive arenas that they do it in now, and the fact that the audience is full of Eurovision fans rather than the stuffed shirts that are only there for the free glass of wine, you know. Because when we did it, everyone's in suits and cocktail dresses, and you know, they're just sitting there thinking, I'll hurry up and get it over with, you know, I want to go and have me glass of Prosecco or Cava, whatever it was then. So they weren't, it's different now, it's much better now, but we need to take it more seriously. We need to put in not just a great singer, because we've had great singers in the past, but we need to do the whole thing like everyone else does. We need to make it a production. We need to make it almost like a musical occasion, like with the special effects and things, and the dancers and the fantastic things that happen. I'll tell you what you need. You need a skirt rip moment. You want an X Factor moment. You need people to want to see that performance again. And we haven't put songs in like that. We haven't put in songs that are good enough or production that is good enough. We have had good singers. We absolutely have, but we haven't given them the platform that they need to win a competition.
It's very interesting to get your views on that. I mean, so to fire through the Bucks Fizz thing then, because I really would like to speak to you about all the other things as well, because you've got such an incredible career. In your career, you've done so many things. So, I mean, how long, because you stayed in Bucks Fizz for quite a long time, and then you left for a period of time.
So I was pregnant, and we, at that time, this was 1993, I left in December 93, December the 11th, 1993, and we were doing bingo halls, and I thought, you know what, I didn't do bingo halls when I was with Coco, why am I doing them now with a band that have had this massive success? So it was, you know, when I got pregnant, there's no way that I was going to stay with the band because I couldn't have children at home and be gigging all over the place. So that was the prime time for me to leave. And also at that time, I'd been presenting television since 1984, and it was getting more and more busy on the TV side. And it was kind of, it was difficult to make the two careers work, because sometimes, you know, I needed to be at Television Centre doing something, but there was a Bucks Fizz gig, and I thought, oh, blimey, what am I going to do here? So it came at the right time for me to leave. I left in 93 and then carried on my TV career. I even, on your passport back in those days, you had to put down your work, whatever you did, what's the word I'm looking for?
Occupation, yeah.
Occupation, that's the word. Yeah. And I had to put down TV presenter, because that's all I was doing. And come 1997, I was on TV 6 days a week, which was absolutely blimmin' ridiculous and overkill. But yeah, that's you know, that's why I left, to have my kids. And TV work was more like a day job, because I would go to usually Television Centre, do my work, and I'd be home again that evening. And often I would take the children with me.
And you did Record Breakers, wasn't it? Record Breakers.
Yeah, I did Record Breakers for 11 series.
Record Breaker. Well, if you're wondering what all that's about, I'm saying nothing. You just have to wait and see.
And others, Eggs and Baker, I did for 5 series, and a programme called The 11th Hour. I did that for 5 or 6 years. Mostly from Telecentre in London, but Eggs and Baker I did from Manchester or Liverpool. I did a programme called The Really Useful Show, which came from Birmingham, and I would go up, I'd have to stay, because that was a Monday to Friday job that was live at 11 o'clock every day, and I would go up there and I would take the kids. I would take my niece with me, who'd look after the children while I was busy, and so it worked. The TV career worked with the family because it was like a proper job. As in a proper job where you get home of the night, which Bucks Fizz wasn't. But then it stopped. It stopped at the end of the 90s. They were starting to go more towards those programmes like the Talking Heads programmes, where you don't have a presenter anymore. And so I wasn't getting offered any jobs. And I thought, oh, blimey, but got to get some work somehow. And it was I was started writing for a magazine. And it was the year 2000. And there was a tour going out called the Here and Now Tour. And it was Paul Young, Kim Wilde, Belinda Carlisle.
Tony Denton, wasn't it?
Tony Denton. First Here and Now Tour. And I wrote about it and I interviewed all these people. And I thought, hang on a minute. We were successful in the 80s. So I spoke to Tony and he went, yeah, get the band together. And it took a while. It took 4 years, but we did it. And that's when I got back together with the rest of them and started work as we couldn't be called Bucks Fizz because Bobby G's wife owns the name. So we were called, I think we were called the original Bucks Fizz then, and then we were called Cheryl, Mike and Jay from Bucks Fizz, and we've been called a lot of different names, and now we're called the Fizz. So I've been working again, singing again properly as the main part of my career since 2004.
What about all the sort of inner fighting, shall we say, with this whole thing with the name and the challenges that, I mean, how did you, not to go into specific details with that, but how did you cope with all, because you strike me as a no nonsense kind of person. You come across as somebody that, you know, you call a spade and you're just straightforward. So how did you cope with all of that, Cheryl?
I didn't cope with it very well, actually, because you see, if I had been Bobby G and my wife owned the name Bucks Fizz, but the rest of Bucks Fizz wanted to use it, I would have gone, you know what? It's only fair because we all won the Eurovision. We each of us owe each of us some kudos for, you know, we all, four of us won the Eurovision. We all have a right to use that name. So let us go out as Bobby G's Bucks Fizz. Let them go out as Cheryl, Mike and Joe from Bucks Fizz. That's fair. That's what I would have said, because I think you have to be fair.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, they didn't. They said, you can't use the name. So we challenged their trademark and we lost. And so we absolutely couldn't use the name Bucks Fizz in any shape or form. I feel a bit bitter about that, because his wife owns it. He doesn't own it. His wife owns it. And she was 9 or 10 when we won the Eurovision Song Contest. So she probably watched and was a big fan. She probably thought, I bet she tied a tea towel around her waist and did the skirt rip, you know. And so for her to say, I can be Bucks Fizz but you can't, I think morally is wrong. It's all about the morals for me. And I think morally she's wrong. Maybe by the letter of the law, she's right, but morally she's wrong. And I think that, to me, is more important. Getting your morals right is more important. So
the Fizz has got yourself and who else is in the Fizz now?
Mike Nolan and Jay Aston. So the three of us from the original line.
So really, I mean, that really is the Bucks Fizz then.
Yeah. When we got to the stage, we're introduced as the Fizz. And I actually make an announcement on stage and say, who are we? And they go, Bucks Fizz. And I go, who are we? And they go, Bucks Fizz. Now, I know that's, you know, possibly opening a can of worms. I don't say that we're Bucks Fizz, but the audience does.
No, so, of course. Yeah.
There you are. I'm not bitter about it. I'm not bitter, but I'm very disappointed in Bobby. Very disappointed that, you know, he could ever think that by calling himself Bucks Fizz that he is. Because he isn't.
No. I mean, surely that would reflect on the shows that they're doing as well, though, because without the people there, I mean, it's a different scenario. Well, so 2004, all the way right through, you've continued on with the Fizz, the Bucks Fizz, but the Fizz. I said it, not you. And I mean. What's been obviously, if we come to the kind of current day, Cheryl, then, I mean, when it comes to, or Rita or Cheryl, let's go, whatever hat we want here. But when we get to the current day, I mean, obviously COVID kicks in. And I mean, just devastation erupts throughout the music industry as far as live performance and so on and so forth. Now, If that's how you're earning your living, if that's what you're doing, you're going out there doing shows, what have you, how badly did that affect you at the time?
Oh, well, as you just said, our industry was absolutely on its knees, wasn't it? Everybody, yeah. Not just the performers and the musicians, but everybody who works in theatre, the technicians, the people in the box office and backstage, you know, everything to do with performance was almost regarded as a hobby. I felt like we weren't taken seriously. Our industry wasn't taken seriously, and I felt very disappointed actually in the government because of that. But there was nothing I could do about it. And we, fortunately, I live in the middle of the countryside in Kent. I live on a farm. It's not our farm. It's a house in the farm. But it means that I'm just surrounded by fields. And both of our children, they're 27 now, our girls, both of our children came home because one was living in London, one was living in Hertfordshire. They both came back because they felt safe here. And their partners came, and we had a great time. It was, the summer was amazing, wasn't it? That,
I don't know, absolutely. Scotland, yeah.
Was down in Kent. It was fantastic. And to be honest, I mean, all our food, we had all our food delivered. And of course, you know, as you take it out the book, you've got your mask on, you've got your gloves on, you've got your spray and your cloth, and you're cleaning everything when you, you know, when you get it out of the box. And it was a bit of a crazy time, really, wasn't it? But it was equally, it was a really nice family time for us. So one of my daughters it affected her really badly, mentally. She didn't cope with it at all well. But I was all right. I was all right. There was nothing to spend money on other than, you know, your general bills and your shopping, which obviously you're getting, you get less. I did grow a load of vegetables and I loved it. And I still do that now. I didn't do it before. And we were very frugal at that time. I didn't get any help from the government because I don't know if you remember, I did Dancing on Ice. In 2017.
She can kill with a smile, she can wound with her eyes, and she can ruin your faith with her casual lies, and she only reveals what she wants you to see. She hides like a child, but she's always a woman to me.
2018, yeah. I did Dancing on Ice, and because I did Dancing on Ice and it was a good wage, 3 years on, they said, well, no, you weren't very well 3 years ago, so you can't have any more money. And so I didn't have any help from the government whatsoever, but Steve did and the kids did. So that was enough for us to get by. And it was getting by, but it was all right. I was okay mentally. I was fine. It was great because we had a great summer. The following summer was awful. Last summer was awful. And we were still in a sort of semi-lockdown position, weren't we? There were still no gigs. It affected Mike Nolan a lot. I spoke to him when there were gigs being offered and he said to me, I don't know if I can do it anymore. So he was affected by it. Anyway, the gigs did eventually start again and
the college.
Not as many this year, really, but we are working again, which is amazing. It's great to come back on stage. I cried the first time I went back on stage and we had an audience. They were wearing masks. They were sitting with two or three seats in between each group of people. And it brought tears to my eyes.
Yeah, different. I think everyone was just, you know, that relief thing of, you know, normality back into life. I mean, what's your, I mean, take, ask everybody this again, because of, you know, I'm old enough when I was a kid, I went to the record shops to buy my records. We picked up the vinyls. It was a big scene. It was what you did with your weekend money or whatever. You went out and bought a record or whatever. And today everything's digital. Everything's streaming and Spotify and iTunes, etc. What's your take on the new music industry?
Oh, well, what can you say about it? I mean, there's nothing we can do about it. I do think that the realization of the vinyl kind of days is missed. I think, like, for instance, my daughter Kyla, she buys vinyl. And so even though, and she's a musician, so she writes and performs her own songs. But it's a Spotify world now, isn't it? You know, yeah. it's everything's on YouTube and Spotify and iTunes and all the others. It's you can't. I mean, you can say what a shame it isn't. You know, you can't go down to Woolworths anymore and look at the what, you know, the top 10 and the top 20. But it's moved on. Times have changed. So you have to go with it. You have to accept it. That's the way things are. It's a digital age, and everything that the kids do now, it's instant as well. Like, for instance, when we're still recording, we're recording with Mike Stock now from Stock Aitken and Waterman. We've had three albums out, and we've got another one coming out next week, I think it is, or the week after. Literally, I spoke to him yesterday, and you know, because it's been a long time since we started recording this album. And what we did with the last album, Smoke and Mirrors, that was released year before last. And on the day of release, it went in the charts at number 4, I think it was, the highest position we'd ever had. It might be number 6, can't remember. But of course, hours later, it dropped. So yeah. The way the charts are now, it's not a weekly chart. It's a minute by minute chart now, you know. It's crazy. But you can't deny it. That's the way it is. And if you want to be a part of it, you've got to go along with it.
I mean, with the career that you've had, Cheryl, again, sorry for asking so many questions, but and the thing about it is my podcast goes out to all the music students, as I say, and kids that are coming into the music industry for the first time. And the idea of the podcast was, well, I would like to speak to people that have actually done it. I went around all the universities and colleges, music colleges, and realized very quickly, dear, they were taught how to use the equipment, they were taught how to use the computers, they were taught how to do this, but they had never had any idea how to get out and do something with their career. You know, this tenacity thing that you've got, or that thing of phoning the studio saying, I can sing, I can type, I can phone, you know, that kind of thing. They don't have that. So what advice would you give from your career? What little bit of magic could you pass on? Something you've learned, perhaps? Or,
well, you've got to believe in yourself for a start. And if you do believe in yourself, if you believe that a job is right for you, then you should try and make it happen. Come, you know, however it is. You need to make phone calls. You can. I was very lucky, but I put myself in a position to be lucky. So, you know, like I say, by ringing the recording studio and just by going to places where you're going to meet the right people. And I wasn't the kind of person to just, you know, start singing at the opening of a fridge. But I did make myself. I knew what I wanted to do, and I knew that there was only one way that it was going to happen, and that was by me doing it. So that when I was sitting in my office in Edgware Road, where I was at the time, and I just thought, there was the advert. If I don't do it now, I probably never will. So I just bit the bullet and picked up the phone and made that phone call and did the audition. I think it's pushing yourself forward to the best of your ability. If you try to fulfill whatever your ambition is, then at the end of the day, whether it's happened or not, you can say, I did it, I did my best. Maybe it didn't happen, but I did my best and I did try. I would hate to think that at the end of, you know, your career, that you would sit back and think, oh, I wish I'd have tried that, I wish I'd have done that. Because that's it, it's over then. If you don't try, you won't succeed. So you have to try. And you have to push yourself. Sometimes you don't feel like it. Sometimes you don't feel strong. Sometimes you feel nervous. I always did. But like doing theatre, I did a lot of theatre stuff, musicals and things, and I used to get so nervous. But at the end, you think, I'm so glad I did that. It's just making yourself strong, even if you feel weak.
Yeah. No, that's fabulous advice. I love it. I love it. Kind of final question, really, Cheryl. I mean, through your career, what's been the most challenging thing you've had to overcome?
Nerves. When I joined Coco, they wouldn't give me a solo song, because if they did, I turned into, do you know, was it Edith Piaf? She had this, she had this wobble in her voice. I turned into Edith Piaf. I couldn't sing without my voice going, because I was so nervous. And eventually I did. We were singing, we were working at the Playboy Club, which is no more, but we were singing, we were the band, the resident band in the Playboy Club for 3 months or something. And they asked me to sing a song, and it was, and it was a Carole King song, so I can't remember what. But honestly, I could not sing it. I couldn't breathe. I couldn't sing. It was just awful. And I said, they'll never, ever give me another solo song. Because I love singing harmony, I love it, but I don't like singing solos. And even like being on stage in the West End, as I was with Footloose, and singing a solo ballad, I mean a ballad and singing it solo, oh, honestly, I used to be, every time I sang it, I used to think, please get through it, please get through it. The relief when it was finished. I do suffer terribly from nerves, still to this day, always have. So that's the one thing that I've really had to contend with, but I've done it.
Yeah, so, I'm amazing. And what would you have said then? What's been the magical pick out moment for you then? Was it winning Eurovision? Was that the thing, or was it a self achievement?
Definitely winning Eurovision, definitely. But also, there's several things, like being asked to do the Christmas Top of the Pops, because you knew then that you were one of the best artists of that year. And we sang Land of Make-Believe, and they put me on wires. And so in the chorus of Land of Make-Believe, I flew, you know, and I was doing the routine in the air. I mean, amazing times. But also going to Australia, seeing my brother Colin in Australia, sitting on a beach in Copacabana Beach in Brazil and singing If You Can't Stand the Heat, going to Chile and doing a concert in front of 60,000 people and seeing them all cheer for you. And when we did Now Those Days Are Gone, they all lit things, and amazing times. I've got so many things that I could say, this isn't the best, but I've got so many sort of that are almost there. Career-wise, absolutely.
I have absolutely loved spending time speaking with you, Cheryl. I mean, you're so humble, so down to earth, lovely person, and I thank you so much for coming on.
Oh, I've loved it. Thank you, Rory. I really enjoyed it.
Done in, couldn't win. I'd only ever kissed before.
You mean you'd only ever kissed?
I thought there's no use getting into heavy petting. It only leads to trouble and seat wetting. All I wanna know is how to go. I've tasted blood and I want more.
More, more.
I'll put up no resistance. I want to stay the distance. I've got an itch to scratch.